Welcome. For those that are first-time visitors, my name is Pastor Rudy, and I am the pastor of this fine church. And I'd like to welcome each and every one of you to today's worship service. Here at St. George's, our whole purpose and desire is to love God and to love people. So, as we come together, let us start our time together, keeping those in our hearts and minds that are suffering all around the world and this nation. Let us pray. Most gracious and all-wise God, we thank you for your Son, Jesus the Christ. And we ask, O God, that you would make your presence known in this place. We ask that you would forgive us of our sins. And we ask, O God, that you would watch over us and protect us from all unrighteousness. Bless our nation and all those around the world that are indeed suffering. Now, God, I ask that you bless your manservant and that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart will be acceptable in your sight. For you are indeed my rock and my redeemer. Amen. And now, if you would you join me in praying the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us for our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now, if you would join me in reciting the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. But on the third day, he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I'm going to be reading from Acts 3, 12 to 19. When Peter saw this, he said to them, "Fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own power of godliness we have made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus. You handed him over to be killed and disowned him before Pilate, though he had decided to let him go. You disowned the holy and righteous one and asked that a murderer be released to you. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this. By faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. It is Jesus' name and the Father and the faith that comes through him that has completely healed him, as you can all see. Now, fellow Israelites, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your leaders, but this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Messiah would suffer. Repent then and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
The sermon title for today's message is, "There is power in the name." The context for today's scripture lesson actually goes back to the Gospel of Luke. For it is in that gospel that we learn how so many people actually failed Jesus. Of course, Luke points a finger at Judas, but he also points to Peter, the chief priest, and the elders. And he also points to the crowd, Pilate, Herod, and the Roman soldiers. In other words, church family, when Jesus was crucified, blood was on the hands of many. And their guilt actually forms the background, if you will, for today's text. However, just before today's text, Peter and John were on their way to the temple for prayer when they came across a man who was lame from birth and was begging for alms. He may have thought that they would give him money, but instead they had something much, much greater in store. Peter said, "Look at us." Then Peter went on to say, "Silver and gold we have not, but what we have I freely give to thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk." Then the Bible says that Peter helped him up, and the man began walking, leaping, and praising God. Church family, when all the people saw this, the Bible tells us that they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had just happened. Then the Bible goes on to say, while the man held on to Peter and John, all the people were astonished and came running to them. Then in today's text, starting in the 12th verse, the Bible says this: when Peter saw this, he said to them, "Fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own power or godliness we had made this man walk?" Church family, it is in this particular moment that Peter seizes an awesome opportunity to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, the risen Savior. This man had been lame from birth, and the crowd had seen him begging at the temple gate every day for years. And in those days, there was no cure for what his ailment was. Therefore, everyone understood that his condition was hopeless. But now they have witnessed this hopeless man walking, leaping, and praising God. You see, church family, there's nothing impossible with God. So it is in this understanding as to why they would give Peter and John the credit for this miracle. It may be hard to understand, but Peter is quick to correct their misunderstanding. Church family, we know that it was not by their power nor by their might that this man was actually healed. However, in verse 16, Peter will tell them who is indeed responsible for this man's healing. But first, Peter preached. Listen to his words in verse 13, which states this: "The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus. You handed him over to be killed, and you disowned him before Pilate, though he had decided to let him go." By stating this in his sermon, by stating the phrase, "the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob," Peter reminds the Jews of their long-standing relationship with God. Then in that same verse, Peter goes on to say that the God of our fathers has glorified his servant, Jesus. Now, with this single statement, Peter makes it known that God has shared his awesome glory with Jesus the Christ. Like God's glory, Christ's glory is revealed in his presence with us, in his work on the cross, and in final judgment. His glory will indeed be made known. And though the pages of the Bible, and through the pages of the Bible, we have seen Jesus' glory revealed time and time again. For it was revealed at the Transfiguration and through his death and his resurrection. And in Luke 21, verse 27, we learn that in his second coming, Jesus will, in a cloud, with power and great glory. And at that time, the Bible says that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is indeed Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So that leads us to our first point. All glory belongs to God. None of it actually belongs to us. All glory belongs to God. Also notice in verse 13 that Peter refers to Jesus as a servant, which brings to mind the suffering service mentioned in Isaiah. A servant who had no good looks or majesty, who was despised and rejected, who has borne our sickness, who was pierced for our transgressions, and punishment that brought our peace was on him. And by his wounds, we are indeed healed. You see, church family, to understand the healing of the lame man, these people that were present must first understand Jesus, who made the healing actually possible. So Peter continues to preach. He continues to preach Jesus. He continues to preach the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. But in his preaching, Peter makes it clear to the crowd and to us today that we are responsible for the death, and so were they, of Christ, by rejecting him rejecting the Messiah. And they did so in spite of Pilate's not guilty verdict. Here's what Peter said in verse 14. You disown the holy and righteous one and ask that a murderer be released to you. Then in verse 15, Peter continues. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this. Again, church family, Jesus was holy and is holy. A man set apart from the beginning. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, lived a sinless life, and was declared by those who knew him to be the Son of God. Yet the crowd demanded the release of a murderer, Barabbas. Therefore, Peter reminds them that their actions killed the author of life, but God. But God's actions, well, they actually raised him from the dead. Church family, Peter goes on in the latter part of this verse to declare that he is a witness to the resurrection of Christ and that death had been defeated by Jesus. In other words, Peter offers his testimony as proof of Jesus' resurrection. And in the next verse, Peter offers the healing of the lame man as proof as well. Verse 16 says this, by faith, in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that has completely healed him, as you can all see. You see, in verse 12, Peter denied that he and John were responsible for the lame man's healing. Now Peter tells the crowd who is indeed responsible. It was God's servant, God's suffering service, Jesus, the holy and righteous one, the author of life. And it is, or was, faith in Jesus' name and Jesus' name alone that made the healing possible. Now the question is whether it was the layman's faith or Peter's faith that brought forth healing power, the healing power of Jesus. And it is in my humble belief or opinion that in this particular case, it is indeed Peter's faith. Church family, it was Peter. It was Peter who said, get up and walk. It was Peter who took the lame man by hand and raised him up. And it was only when Peter brought the man to his feet that his feet and ankles were made strong. Which leads us to our second point. Point number two, God uses us for his glory. Verse 17 states this, now, fellow Israelites, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your leaders. Notice the sequence of events. First, Peter delivered a powerful word, a word of judgment. Then he offers a word of healing. In the name of Jesus. But now Peter is offering a word of grace. He recognized and acknowledged the ignorance of those who opposed Jesus, all those responsible for his crucifixion. So now that they know the error of their ways, Peter is opening a door, the door to God's forgiveness, which is consistent with the first of Jesus' last seven words from the cross when he said this, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. Yet ignorance is not sufficient for forgiveness. Church family, repentance is. Repentance is required for forgiveness. turning away from our sins and turning towards God. Point number three, we must repent. And God is faithful. The Bible tells us this. God is faithful to forgive us of all unrighteousness. The door of forgiveness is indeed open, but we must be willing to walk through it. Peter confirms what has happened in the final two verses of this text. Verses 18 and 19 state this: but this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Messiah would suffer. Repent then and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped away, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord. Church family, the prophets of old, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Zechariah, and others foretold the coming of Christ. They talked about his suffering and the need for repentance, which leads to forgiveness as well as refreshment in the Lord, which leads us to eternal life. So again, as we depart from this place, but not from the Spirit of the living God, let us all be challenged and remember these three things that came from today's text. Number one, all glory belongs to God. Number two, God uses us for his glory. And number three, must repent. So be it. Amen. And now for the benediction. And now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his throne with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Father, may all power and dominion be thine. Amen.